god, I was supposed to have this done over a year ago. Why is it always the videos about my favorite show, about time travel, that I just can't get done in a timely fashion? Whatever, it's actually the 5th anniversary of the start of Doctor Who Series 10 as I record this, so I guess it all works out. Speaking of lengthy periods of time, it's embarrassing how dismissive I was of this season of television back in the day. Yeah, for those who didn't know, I did unscripted weekly reviews for this show back when it aired 5 years ago. I don't know what it was about 20-year-old me, but he just had the hardest time getting invested in the adventures of 12, Bill, and Nardole. It certainly wasn't burnout with the show, as I'd actually really enjoyed most of Series 9, but for whatever reason I had this string of episodes ranked lowest of the entire modern series for a long time. Rather than dwell on the bad taste of past me, though, I'm gonna make up for it. So, here's a modestly thorough look at the series and how it holds up, having rewatched it multiple times years later. My working argument is that when Series 10 of Doctor Who is good, which is most of the time, it's some of the best stuff the Moffat era, and by extension this whole show, has to offer. If not, maybe even the best, period. But on the occasion when it's bad, it's boring, poorly structured, unmemorable garbage. But which is which? Where do I fall in my rankings of these stories? Strap in as I tackle each story in the series from worst to best, and of course, keep in mind that this is all my opinion. I hope I provide a bit of interesting insight into my own thought process, and I hope that you let me know in the comments what you think of this video and this series. Also, subscribing certainly wouldn't hurt my feelings. Also, spoilers! Duh. You know, I actually really dig the Ice Warriors. I suppose I should say I dig the Ice Warriors aesthetically. They're a great, iconic, old-school alien design, and I wish their only major appearances in the modern series didn't do them such a disservice. Unfortunately, I don't dig Mark Gatiss. His stories are, in my opinion, often the weakest the show has to offer, shallow in their characterization and storytelling, overly reliant on callbacks and fan service, and really weakly plotted. Gatiss is a great concept guy. He should come up with premises for stories and just let other people handle the execution. Case in point, Empress of Mars really hurt my feelings the first time I watched it, because it felt like Gatiss was punishing me for giving him continuous chances to wow me with his work. My current feelings aren't nearly as hyperbolic, but I can't find it in me to call this good television. I have no investment in any of the secondary characters here. Gatiss loves to default to broad archetypes with little if any added depth when writing one-off characters, and here is no exception. Catchlove, in particular, is the same cartoonishly insecure and selfish, power-hungry instigator this show has portrayed countless times in countless stories, surrounded by an incredibly stock group of soldiers. None of these guys are compelling to watch, either alone or in scenes with the Doctor, though I suppose the Colonel gets really interesting in the moment of resolution with the Empress. Not interesting enough that I, you know, remember his name, but that singular scene is actually really good. Unfortunately, it's a bit undercut by...
This is Alpha Centauri! Welcome to the universe!
Yeah, that. This is a bridge too far, am I wrong? Like, I get that the meat of the story resolved with the aforementioned scene, but you can't have a completely contextless, unseated fan service callback to a creature that hasn't shown up in decades be the ending of your story. I'm not crazy, right? That's just a really, really bad move as a writer. You've just watered down the impact of your one really good scene by following it up immediately with this silly, out-of-nowhere beat that will only mean anything to the smallest minority of viewers. Do not try to tell me that 80% of the people who watched this story in 2016 knew who Alpha Centauri was. If you're gonna put this here, have it be, I don't know, a throwaway line by the Doctor. Not this appearance presented with a frankly weird amount of focus, screen time, pomp, and circumstance. The conflict of this story escalates on pure contrivance and forced character turns. I never realized until rewatching this story how much I hate the trope where peace talks break down and erode not because of any character-based decision, but because someone fires their gun off by pure accident or out of nerves. Ugh, and speaking of tired tropes, this episode literally has the soldier looking at a picture of his best girl and contemplating retirement before getting got scene. Like, come on, man, Mark, you're a professional. Also, Catchlove successfully threatening an Ice Warrior with a knife is... something. This story is dumb, and it's not even the exciting kind of dumb. That said, I'm not sure if it's actually the most boring story of this series. I spoke only somewhat facetiously a second ago. I remember being almost criminally bored watching Eaters of Light for the first time. This was one of a crop that I think really weighed down my opinion of the series at the time, and while on a first watch there's a story coming up whose good points were entirely overshadowed for me by its lackluster ending, and Empress of Mars was, let's just say, very typical of Gatiss, Eaters of Light was just, like, weirdly difficult to pay attention to. Something about it just threatened to put me to sleep, and you know, I honestly think that those aspects are the very same things that serve to make it unique and atmospheric. The score, the color palette, the pacing that's almost glacial by this show's standards, including lots of drawn-out, subdued conversations. I don't know, conceptually, it's neat to see this show just do a mood piece, but I'm sorry, I just find it really dull to actually sit through. Hard to invest in a way that's not really rational. I regularly have to remind myself that this story even exists, which sounds really mean, but it's true. It sucks because it has a lot of little things I do like. The whole bit with the talking crows is a great little bit of magical realism, adding to the whole vibe the story has as a folk tale. That whole the crows are remembering bit at the end is just on the knife's edge between dumb and endearingly earnest. I also love when Doctor Who does interdimensional, and the eponymous Light Eaters are a really neat concept and design. Unfortunately, it's barely on screen for very long, and it's gotten out of the way very quickly. It's a testament to how not fully engaged I was with this episode that by the end I needed to be reminded about the whole hyperbolic time chamber aspect of the dimensional portal, despite us dedicating a whole scene to explaining it. There's an idea to this story being a coming-of-age tale for the Vikings and Romans, a narrative about maturity that ends with them knocking down the Doctor's own immature compulsion to murder himself. Though, granted, I don't think that's really in the text of the episode, so much as it is maybe accidental subtext. Either way, it's fun to think about, and it fits with 12's character. What I can say about Eaters of Light is that I can absolutely see why a certain kind of person might give it the highest of marks. I'm just not that kind. But hey, so long as there aren't any more particularly unexciting mood pieces in this series, we should be fine going forward. Knock knock is knuckle. Ah, nuts. Okay, now I really am being hyperbolic. Knock Knock is a much better episode than I remembered it being. I used to hate this story. I found it flat and boring, and the twist at the end felt insanely arbitrary, almost insultingly so. I still don't really like it. I feel like if there's a central theme or arc here, it's not conveyed very well, and Bill's friends never showing up again makes it feel like a wasted opportunity that none of them really got any characterization. It's good to have a healthy-sized party of characters to dwindle off in any haunted house romp, but I think this story would be better served by cutting down on the number of these guys. Frankly, I'd cap it at the Doctor, Bill, and three others max. Give these guys time to breathe and make them feel like less of a collective, singular entity. Maybe even give one or two of them a really solid character arc. I don't know, it just feels like this story is missing the meat and potatoes, missing the things that typically make a Doctor Who episode a worthwhile sit, beyond just being spooky. On that note, though, I'm usually not too averse to Everybody Lives endings, and part of me is glad that Bill didn't have to spend future episodes mourning characters I don't care about, but in the context of this story, having all of the friend group just make it out okay really robs it of its teeth. Pulling the curtain back a bit, one of the metrics I'm using to judge these episodes is how well I remember them or my feelings about them given some distance from the last time I saw it. Beyond the central twist of the climax, which is indeed effective, grotesque, and tragic, Knock Knock just ain't one that sticks in my head. There's not really any standout lines, moments, or characters. Reflecting on it, I just don't think there's much to make me go, "Yeah, I'm glad I watched that." I'm not gonna lie to you guys, this is tough. My feelings toward Twice Upon a Time are, scattershot. This is the one I've had to rewatch the most, just to get some kind of internal consensus. Some days, looking back on this story, I think it belongs firmly above the next pick on the list. And other days, I think I'm crazy for not putting it at the very bottom. I would be justified in leaving it off this list entirely, but like a lot of Christmas specials, it's basically a series epilogue, and I think it belongs here. Right now, I feel like the only way I can really justify this placement is that it's memorable. It sticks in my mind, at least some of it draws the intended emotional response out of me, and it's got that typical Moffat earnest thematic ambition. And you know, on a more shallow note, here's a thing that a lot of people don't know about me. I'm always gonna be a sucker for a multi-doctor story. Seeing different actors with their own tics and quirks and performances play variations on one person in the same room is inherently stimulating to me. It's the furthest you could ever hope to take the idea of one person actually being different people across different moments in time. And just watching that concept play out with my favorite fictional character of all time is almost guaranteed to carry a scene for me, regardless of how well it's actually executed. Making a plot point of the Christmas armistice is also an incredibly meaningful, clever move, which alone grants this story a lot of brownie points. It's an educational moment regarding one of the most hope-filled fairy tale moments in human history. And it just charges you with so much Christmas joy, and I love it! There's other aspects to the ending that I'm less sure about. The very idea of testimony as this being who basically keeps a version of every single person who has ever lived alive in perpetuity feels like such a Moffat concept. Like, of course, the guy whose every story is basically a meditation on death would go out on the premise that no one ever actually dies, in the existential sense. And quite frankly, I'm just really unsure how to feel about that. On some level, at least, I appreciate that Moffat ended his run on the show not with a massive universe and century-spanning epic, but rather a comparatively small, low-stakes plot that just broadly tackles themes and motifs which he'd been parsing out on the show for years. That's probably what every writer in his position should do, given the chance. And yet, there's genuinely so much about this story to dislike.
The ship. You still call it a ship.
12. You've called it a ship. In this series, what are you on? And can I have some? More substantially, starting from premise, 12 choosing not to regenerate feels really arbitrary. With the way the last story ended, it was down to this episode to justify his reluctance to regenerate as a narrative choice, and I really don't think it ever comes to fruition. By the end of things, I really couldn't tell you why it is that this story happens. What made 12 so darn tired all of a sudden? It sucks, because it feels like the story actually has a solid idea on how to handle one's refusal to regenerate, whereas with 12, it just feels incomplete. The idea that he's just so worn and spent that he's ready to actually die this time doesn't feel remotely earned. For another note, why is Rusty the Dalek here at all? In terms of plot, there's absolutely nothing accomplished with his presence that justifies nearly half the special being spent trying to find and speak with him. The most comprehensive database in the universe could have been literally anything. And man, the whole Lethbridge-Stewart thing just bothers me so much. The first time Moffat pulled the whole homaging the Brig card in Series 6, it felt real heartwarming. Since then, it's always struck me as really bad taste, like dangling a corpse on stage in front of an applause sign. Just in the context of the story, it cheapens the idea that anyone, even a seemingly random person, is important. The captain's role in the episode would honestly land so much better if he had no connection to any established characters. They Rise of Skywalker'd it, man! And God, I wrote the first draft of this script back when Rise of Skywalker was a timely reference. That'll give you some perspective. That's not even touching on how contrived it is that nobody asks him his name for the entire special just so that we can maintain the surprise. There's a lot of Moffatisms that just don't work for me in this one, big and small, and that's one of the bigger ones. By which I mean spending upwards of 10 minutes of screen time not really doing much but dancing around a twist that doesn't have to be a twist. Steven just loves having characters in the know about things the audience isn't just talk around the relevant information until he can deliver it in the punchiest way possible. It's the epitome of how he prioritizes cleverness over efficiency in his works. He'd rather win an imaginary chess match with his viewers than he would practice economy of storytelling. I swear, you could truncate and reutilize a good chunk of this story's screen time if you just had the Doctor be upfront about who it is he's visiting when he gets the idea to consult Rusty. There's also a dedicated scene to filleting the Doctor as the ultimate force of good in the universe, without whom the scales of good and evil would ultimately be unbalanced. Man, I hate that scene. Not only is it forced, with this weird, unprecedented sentiment from one that he left Gallifrey to determine what the balance of good and evil in the universe is, but Steven inflating the Doctor's importance has always served to be kind of alienating for me. Much like the Lethbridge-Stewart thing, it makes it feel like absolutely nothing meaningful or important happens in this universe beyond this character's purview. The sexist comments from One and the Captain at Bill's expense are also cringeworthy. Also, someone forced Stephen Moffat to never, ever make another browser history joke for as long as he lives. What, did he think he had to get a last one in on the way out? Hearing I Am the Doctor and the theme for Doomsday again was nice, and I'm sure it was a fun little treat for Murray Gold to include them in the last story that he scored. That said, the whole thing with One finding out about the Doctor of War business feels super underdeveloped. It gets called back to at the end, but through the rest of the story, that development informs literally nothing about how One and 12 interact. I know a lot of people who despise this story, like it makes them legit mad, and I can't even blame them. For me, even Moffat's worst scripts know how to keep a story superficially engaging enough that I'm never outright bored, and it pushes enough of my feel-good buttons just enough that I can always tolerate sitting through it. But it's not really something I hold a lot of affection for. And that hurts to say, because this is Moffat's last series, and the first of his series in a while, which I feel had a really consistent level of quality from his scripts. But his final one, his kiss goodbye to the entire show, just feels sloppy and only really works esoterically. I don't feel comfortable calling it a bad story, but I feel less comfortable calling it a good one. Even more than the previous, A Lie of the Land is one I think has aged better than my memory of it. Spoiling the format a bit, this story represents what I consider the passing of a threshold, from stories that I still think are quite bleh to stories that I now think are actually really solid. Lie of the Land rests firmly in the middle. There's a lot of blah about this one, but I also actually have substantial positives to speak to. Imagine that. What really elevates this above the previous ones is its nature as a Pearl Mackie showcase. She really has to carry most of this one, and she does a magnificent job. This is true throughout the story, but in particular, the argument between Bill and the Doctor is spectacular. One of the standout scenes of the series. And man, have I never thought about how good Murray Gold's score is in that scene. Speaking of which, hearing a version of This Is Gallifrey in the discussion with Missy is rad as well. Really, everything about both of those dialogue scenes is solid, solid gold. The issues come with this story as a comparative letdown to a conceptually arresting trilogy. This episode just isn't as non-stop compelling for me as the two episodes which set it up. It's very procedural outside of the previously mentioned standout scenes, which isn't bad, not at all, but it keeps things from feeling quite as compelling on screen as they are on paper. The entire planet has been enslaved, and the plot to resolve that has this real feeling of just going through the motions. This is also another one that suffers from a really weak climax, and as I'm sitting down with it, this is the one that always pulls me right out of the story. I feel like there's part of an idea that works with the whole Bill's mom resolution, the notion that Bill has cultivated this idealized image of the woman, something that the mind-manipulating monks can't tamper with because it's an emotional memory that never really existed. There's something there. And it's an aspect of Bill's character that we set up as soon as we meet her, so that's a nice bit of reincorporation. But I'm sorry, in execution, it's just so lame. It's one of those things that's well-seeded as a character moment, but not remotely earned as a plot point. I'm also not sure what new it really tells us about Bill to have things resolved this way. I'm not sure what growth it represents, if any, or if it's even meant to. Overall, this is a pretty neat episode with insular moments of greatness dragged to lukewarmness. lukewarm by a straight-up nonsensical climax. But whatever you can say about this episode, it does give us my liking. So, this is a bit weird. The quality jump which we are about to experience with the rest of this list is big enough to require mad hops. Starting here, we're getting to the real gold. The stories that convinced me to make this video. Stories that are not only solid, but genuinely really strong and endlessly rewatchable. Oxygen is the work of one Jamie Matheson, writer of Series 8's instant classics Flatline and Mummy on the Orient Express, and co-writer for the solidly entertaining Girl Who Died in Series 9. Oxygen lies somewhere between those two for me. It's missing some of the strengths of Matheson's Series 8 contributions, like a perfectly flowing structure and strong supporting cast, but it's generally a banger script with things on its mind and a compelling premise. The air you breathe as an object of resource scarcity is the kind of idea I'm surprised hasn't popped up in this show before, or just become more ubiquitous in sci-fi media in general. Maybe it's just living in 2022, but this seems like such a foregone conclusion for how corporations would actually act that I'm shocked more writers haven't displayed that foresight. This is the apex of an anti-capitalist sentiment running under the whole season, and it's a brilliant demonstration of the very real apathy corporations show toward human life. This is another story with no real typical on-screen villain. Only the force of big business systematically murdering its workers for being too expensive to keep alive. That's biting stuff, and I wish this show would be more overt and uncompromising with its political commentary more consistently. As is weirdly often the case in stories that are set in a space station, the supporting cast here is pretty interchangeable. They're not bad, just wholly unremarkable. I also don't think anyone believed Bill had died partway through the episode, though the scene of the Doctor leaving her behind is really great drama. The brave, brazen commentary and the tension inherent is really what makes this one sing. It makes just enough changes to a reliable show formula to not just be serviceable, but memorable. It's held back only a little by this dryness it has, which I'm not sure how I'd go about fixing. The ending, where the Doctor is still blind, is also pretty dang hot, though it's undercut by being undone just two episodes later. Speaking of which... Pyramid at the End of the World is an episode that strikes me as just a real creative and different concept for this show. I love how that's established right out the gate with the previously on segment flipping between previously and now, framed as Bill regaling her date with the story of 12's experiences in the last episode. That's just so clever. As the middle chapter of the Monk trilogy, this is a great follow-up to what was already an interesting setup premise-wise. The title itself is really kooky, and I like that the episode commits to playing its kooky premise as straight as possible even as the oddness just escalates. This is a story with a pyramid housing invincible, shapeless invaders who choose to appear as zombie monks and spend basically a whole episode asking really, really nicely if you could just let them take over the planet, please. It's a hoot, and having our characters deliberate over whether to acquiesce at the possible alternative of human extinction is just a fun exercise. I really love that this is a story where the end of the world comes not as the result of a villain plot, but as the result of a dozen tiny little human errors the Doctor had not even the slightest reason to pay attention to. The Doctor tries to unite the biggest political and military forces in the world to combat the monks, and succeeds, and it amounts to nothing because the world is only a broken pair of glasses or a bad hangover away from ending at any given moment. This episode is all about the deliberate, methodical process of attempting to stop Armageddon when you don't know what causes it. And while I've seen many call it boring, even on my first viewing, I really appreciated that approach. Modern Doctor Who tries so often to maintain this dramatic, kinetic feeling in the way it's plotted, and I really like that this story is mostly people in rooms just trying to negotiate and suss out a situation that hasn't come to pass yet, all while a literal ticking clock hangs over everything. All the drama and tension pivots around the Doctor being just a bit too slow by half as he puts his genius mind towards finding out what he's even meant to be saving the world from, and it's just such a unique dynamic for an episode of this show. The Doctor having been declared President of the World is a holdover from Series 8 and 9, which I've personally never cared for. But thankfully, this episode really doesn't lean on it for much more than a reason to grant him access to such high-stakes discussions and personnel. The Monks are really interesting villains, basically intergalactic mob toughs promising Earth's protection at the expense of willful servitude. I like that their desire to rule only via humanity's own consent isn't like a prerequisite of the species, but purely practical choice. Really love this, is that the Doctor successfully manages to pull off a plan to save the day, makes all the right moves, and then is fouled by a combination lock. Operating blind has led to numerous tiny slip-ups and oversights for two episodes worth of time already, and now it's this tiniest of tiny things that dooms the world to enslavement. Hubris has always been the Doctor's most consistent character flaw, and I like that without emphasizing it too much, this story boils down to that hubris and overconfidence torpedoing a great plan because of something so stupid. It's genuinely a brilliant ending, with the first thing the Doctor gets to see with his returned sight being his plan going off without a hitch, all too late to mean anything. It's strong stuff, and an episode I can always go back to for something thoughtful and different. Extremis is, if you can believe it, the only Series 10 story which I recognized as something not just good, but great, as it aired. Ask the me of 5 years ago, and this would have been number one on the list with a bullet. This was the first episode of the show in a long while that Stephen Moffat had written which wasn't the premiere, finale, or a special of some kind, and it was just really cool to see him do something comparatively low-key and self-contained. Moffat is really good at exploring and coming up with neat sci-fi concepts, or putting creative spins on well-worn ones. But so often, his stories are so chock-full of stuff that many of his best ideas feel like they don't have the room to breathe. Extremis takes a simple, trusty sci-fi idea and rings it for every conceivable ounce of existential horror. What if the world was a simulation, specifically created by the Doctor himself to prepare for an incoming alien invasion? But the only way the characters, or the audience, are able to piece that together is by following a breadcrumb trail of suicides committed by everyone who finds out the nature of their reality. It's so damn dark, it's insane. It's not without a fair bit of levity, but this is maybe the most unchild-friendly this show has ever gone, just on the level of basic premise. You usually get extremely morbid moments packaged in a story that could easily be a fun romp, or premises that aim more for spooks than outright dread, but this is literally a whole story built around swaths of people killing themselves. Yeah, like, comment, and subscribe for more lighthearted fun. The idea that the simulation is one of the Doctor's own creation is also just something that tickles me on so many levels. I always like to describe Extremis as the Doctor watching an episode of his own show, and making that a last-minute twist allows the kooky idea of the Doctor watching a hypothetical version of an upcoming conflict to play out with genuine stakes. This sense of dread I'm talking about is really conveyed best in Bill and Nardole's scenes. They both despair increasingly as they find out what's going on a hair too late. And my favorite scene has to be the moment at CERN, where they barely escape a mass suicide via dynamite. And I'm sorry, I'm still talking about a Doctor Who episode, right? This is also the story where we uncover the presence of Missy in the Doctor's vault. And while those flashbacks feel a bit arbitrary in this story, they're not bad scenes. I have my thoughts about how Missy's presence is handled structurally across the season, which I likely won't get into in this video, but I was glad to have the vault mystery box opened so comparatively early. Watching it, Extremis feels like one of those ideas Moffat had to have rattling around in his brain for years, and if I'm right about that, then I'm glad he got it on the screen. It's amazing stuff, and that it holds up so well yet is still only number 5 speaks to the strength of what's left to cover. Smile is another one that I used to find really slow and dull back in the day. Unlike the other ones which I've stamped with the boring label, this one has actually aged spectacularly, and its methodical, sterile vibe is something I've grown to really appreciate. The tension of watching the Doctor and Bill try to manage their emotions as they uncover this incredibly morbid situation in the colony they found is palpable, and the grief as plague concept is brilliant. There's no bad guy in this episode, only a fault of human wishfulness, and I'm really impressed with how this story manages to be about the dangers of overly optimistic thinking without becoming overly cynical to compensate. It's depressingly realistic to imagine humanity designing robots with the task of maintaining happiness, only to not define the opposite of happiness as healthy and beneficial in its own right, leading to a massacre on anyone who gets too sad. That's just such a smart idea with a lot of applicability. Don't get so worried about keeping things happy that you make grief into an enemy that needs to be eliminated. And always remember to consider the role of sadness in the human condition. I love, love, love that setup and payoff with the Magic Haddock story and how it plays into this theme, especially as someone unfamiliar with that tale. That's one of those little bits that I love from this show, the way it conveys the Doctor's thought process and just how ahead of the companion and the viewer he is. It's not patting itself on the back for how smart it is, just naturally allowing this character to operate on his own wavelength and letting the viewer reflect to themselves just how fast his thinking is. This story actually reminds me of The Power of Three from Series 7, both in the heavy focus on the Doctor-Companion relationship, but also the way it suffers a bit from having a rushed fix-everything-with-a-press-of-the-sonic-screwdriver resolution. I think this is maybe also an episode that ends with some iffy thematic implications, with the Doctor consigning humanity to living with a species that is, by his own admission, all-powerful relative to them. The rushed nature of that climax is really the only big issue with this story. Not enough so as to be ineffective, but beyond even my reservations, the specifics of the new human Vardy situation and how exactly the Doctor has changed things could have used, like, another minute of dialogue to iron out into complete clarity. As it stands, I have a lot of questions, in particular about the whole rent thing. For a series of episodes full of such conscious economic commentary, it's just weird that that bit is dropped in here, when I'm not sure how the Vardy have a concept of money or if the humans have any money on them. But honestly, with how effective the rest of the story is, I can stand to end on a bit of plot fuzziness. This episode really highlights what the 12th Doctor and Bill have as a very interesting Doctor-Companion dynamic, because they spend several months to a year together forming a relationship before their first adventure in the TARDIS even happens. That sense of immediate familiarity comes through in this episode. There's all the glee and star-stricken curiosity of the first proper trip in the TARDIS, but the two mains already have a fully formed friendship that's immediately appealing. I don't even mind at all that much of the episode's plot is a big wait-out-the-clock cul-de-sac as the Doctor and Bill investigate their situation without actually impacting much. And it helps that the story fully dedicates itself to exploring that character dynamic and letting the sense of atmosphere and tension build through the investigation. It's a two-hander for a good three-quarters of the runtime, where other stories would definitely feel compelled to wake the humans up from their pods much earlier and make the conflict between they and the Vardy robots a much more extensive, lengthy thing. Of the two options, I much prefer what we went with. Frankly, I'm surprised the show doesn't adopt this story structure more often. I would have loved to see the Chibnall era do something like this, with just our main characters conversing with each other as they try to parse out a mystery with no one else to help or hinder them. Smile, in my opinion, is a really under-discussed gem. I used to prefer part one of this two-parter to the second, but on viewing for this list, World Enough in Time and The Doctor Falls are starting to feel weirdly reversed for me. I used to not care much for The Doctor Falls at all, and I was a dang idiot because of the character work being done there is, pardon the pun, masterful. So much so, in fact, that I did a whole video exclusively about it. Go check that out. World Enough in Time, meanwhile, is still a strong piece of television with a strong, tense premise and great, moody presentation, but I can't help but feel like it's dragged down slightly by some things which I'll touch on in a bit. The time dilation thing is a great concept, making compelling use of real-world science. It starts out as merely intriguing before it quickly starts to add to the bleakness of Bill's predicament. The choice for the story to literally name itself in dialogue as a stealth successor for Genesis of the Daleks, but for the Cybermen, is certainly bold. And in the end, I think it's kind of earned. With what's done in exploring Bill's introduction to the Cybermen and her own transformation into one, this really does feel like as definitive a story for the Cybermen as Genesis was for the Daleks, and it's certainly the most justice the Cybermen as a concept have ever been done by the modern series. Bill's conversion is freaking heartbreaking, dude. The scene where the Doctor slowly tries to break the news to her is almost painful to witness, not just in the dialogue, but in the super striking visual of her seeing the Cyberman shadow she casts. Bill gets put through the ringer on her way out of the show, and it's her stuff that really carries both parts of the story to all-time greatness. She more than earns her happy ending via Heather Ex Machina, and from the performances to Murray Gold's score, there's something just genuinely magical about their final scene. I've mostly avoided talking about her so far, despite having some build-up in previous episodes, but I've never quite been a massive Missy fan, and her dialogue throughout this story is hit and miss for me. Those first 5 or 6 minutes of World Enough in Time with her just vamping around, pretending to be the Doctor, that stuff has one or two good lines, but on the whole is really quite tiresome for me. By contrast, the opening minutes of The Doctor Falls are great, full of fun, twisty moments from the Doctor, and in contrast to the previous episode, characterization for Missy that I actually find really compelling. Any issues I might generally have with Missy are thankfully offset by just how good she is in moments of pathos and drama, opposite both the Doctor and her past incarnation. Not only do Sim and Gomez have a great, twisted chemistry, but I like how we build on the Sim Master's already existing barely hidden sexism as he torments Bill and looks down on his own future self. Honestly, what justifies his presence here at all is that complete, unrelenting cruelty. The way this master exists on the polar opposite end of the spectrum to 12, a doctor who, at this point in his life, has fully self-actualized into a figure of pure kindness and empathy. For once, it takes the incredibly cartoonish, try-hard vibe of this master's evil and makes a point with it. This story is probably the best material that either of these masters get, by a wide margin. And look, I love Sacha Dhawan's master, I vastly prefer him to both Sim and Gomez outside the confines of this story, but man, do I agree with the master that the character couldn't ask for a better ending than this. And Michelle Gomez's performance, Jesus Christ, this woman is an acting goddess. Her face after the Doctor's speech, the way she's visibly at war with herself and it's torturing her. I can say this with confidence, this episode is the peak of the master. In Modern Who, absolutely, but also possibly the entirety of the program, period. The closest thing I have to a complaint about this story is, unfortunately, kind of pervasive. This is very much a story about our main characters. The Doctor, the Masters, Bill, and a little bit Nardole. Everyone else in this story is perfunctory and ill-defined. Blue Guy is a very conspicuous plot device, the hospital workers are barely there, and the farm folk, which we're trying to save in part 2, don't really engage me. I know they're not really supposed to exist beyond creating broad stakes for our mains, but it does bug me, and not being able to fully invest in the kids whose lives we're trying to save is the main reason I was always dismissive of The Doctor Falls before watching it for this video. My friend and podcasting co-host Danny mentioned in our way back discussion of The End of Time that the best regeneration stories don't play out as portentous, prophecy-laden dirges, but rather simply adventures where the Doctor happens to not get lucky at the end. And I like that that's how this plays out. Yes, the Doctor doesn't actually regenerate by the end of this one, but he's put in the position to, and had you not known this was going to end that way, you'd have no reason to assume so. No weird future-telling ladies or Ood predicting his quote-unquote death episodes in advance, no series arc building to the Doctor's final end, just the Doctor and company coming into a perilous scenario where the Doctor happens to take a critical hit. And I'ma be real with you, regardless of how I feel about how it's paid off in Twice Upon a Time, the cliffhanger of 12 bumping into his original incarnation here is an all-time great. It's just such a banger of a story, man. Though, you know, I suppose, what even is an ending without a solid starting point? I'm a massive sucker for any story that functions as an effective jumping-on point or gateway into this show. I've never thought to question why that is. I think I just love the idea of a show like this with so many different points of entry I could use to show newcomers why I love it. The pilot is up there with The 11th Hour and Smith and Jones as feeling like an impeccably structured breath of fresh air for a show that was starting to feel way too bloated and melodramatic. Introducing the Doctor first through the eyes of Bill Potts as her enlightened, secretive physics professor is a great literalization of the usual Doctor-companion-student-teacher dynamic. And it's so funny to me that what's maybe the best job the show has ever done at naturally and seamlessly introducing its core character and premise to a new audience comes in Capaldi's third year and Moffat's sixth. Like the rest of the series at its best, the pilot puts character first and gives us a pretty swell outsider's portrait of the man 12 has grown to be, as well as his philosophy on life and the universe before we even get a hint about time travel or dimensional transcendence. And yet, we leave plenty of tantalizing questions unanswered to be filled in later. Gotta say, I love the time and relative dimensions in space speech. It's that classic Moffat metatextual writing, but here it's definitely more meaningful and revelatory than it is too cute by half. Bill feels like a fully realized, relatable character within just a scene of meeting her, and for having very little screen time, her doomed romance with Heather is incredibly engaging. Heather's possession by the alien pilot program and the ensuing chase is both genuinely creepy and a great means of blitzing the viewer through all they need to know about the TARDIS and the show's general MO. And when it takes a turn for the tragic at the end, every last bit of that final conversation between Heather and Bill is perfect. From the reveal that the pilot just wanted to invite Bill along as a means of keeping Heather's final promise, to the tears that Bill doesn't think are hers, every aspect of this scene is pure gold. After two prior appearances, Nardole has his dynamic with 12 worked out to a fine point by this story, and more than justifies what I remember many of us thinking was a weird decision to keep him in the cast. I honestly wish I had more to say about this one, given its nearly top spot, but what works about it is just so simple and easy to see. It's dang near a masterclass in how to introduce this show, and it's the gold standard I think an episode should strive to hit if it wants to bring in new viewers in a compelling way. But with that being the case, what could possibly be there for an episode to snatch the number one spot away from this? Well, I hope you guys have a lot of patience. That's right, baby! At number one, it's the one, the only, Thin Ice. And as for why it's number one, God, you're gonna hate this. For why it's number one, you're just gonna have to wait and stay tuned. I swear this was always the plan, and I'm not just doing this because I've been writing and rewriting this list for over a year, and also my throat is killing me. I love everything about Thin Ice so much that I wouldn't feel right giving it anything less than its own whole video. Much like I did for Demons of the Punjab. Watch that one, by the way. So, that's exactly what I'm gonna do. Subscribe if you haven't already to see the mega in-depth review for Thin Ice when it drops, and give this video its own like and share in the meantime. Doctor Who was a big reason I even started this YouTube channel back in the day, and I'd dig it if my stuff about this show in particular could get some love. For now, though, I'll leave this video by reiterating my overall thoughts on Series 10. Moffat and Capaldi's final run of episodes on this show is, on average, something like Doctor Who fully realized. I refrain from saying Doctor Who at its peak because those opening entries on this list were really quite lackluster, but when Series 10 hits, it exemplifies more than most series why Doctor Who will forever be my favorite show on television. Ironically, for being the season where Moffat feels least like an auteur driving the vibe of the whole show, it's the one I really think he should be most proud of, and that's actually saying a lot. But what do you think of Series 10? Where does it land in the pantheon of this show, and where do you rank its episodes relative to each other? Let me know in the comments, and I'll see you in the future.